Amidst the escalating global warming situation, Uganda is in need of planting more trees. This requires concerted effort from farmers who are willing to participate in tree planting initiatives. In today's edition of Harvest Money, we focus on the importance of tree farming and have invited a successful tree farmer as our guest. Tree farming in Uganda has proven to be a lucrative venture with the potential to generate millions in revenue. However, it is important to note that this is a long-term endeavor that requires patience. The types of trees you choose to grow will depend on several factors, including the time it takes for them to mature. For example, timber trees may require 15 to 20 years to reach maturity. Construction poles can be grown in 3 to 4 years, while transmission poles might take 8 to 15 years. Additionally, successful tree farming also depends on the size of your land and the market demand for the specific tree species you choose to cultivate. Our guest for today's episode is Dr. Bernard Obah, a highly experienced tree farmer from West Nile. Dr. Obah has been a lecturer of agroforestry at Makerere University for over 2 decades. Recently, he founded a company called West Nile Foresters with the aim of promoting agroforestry in the region. The primary objective of his venture is to bridge the socio-economic gap among communities in the area. During our visit to his farm, Dr. Barr graciously shared the background story of how he embarked on this farming journey.
The work we do here on producing seedlings is very sensitive. So to make sure that the place is safe and clean, we have to secure the boundaries so that animals don't come in to destroy the seedlings. So it was important to secure the whole boundary first before we could even get started. We have started with seedlings, but from this year on, we are moving into producing in the farm. This is just the start. We are in finishing the third year. So the focus has been building this place to produce quality seedlings. Then from this year, we will go and establish forests and orchards for some of the seedlings we are producing. So it's just a starting. But the aim is to produce quality products also, so that we cover aspects of the value chain where we can be able to train farmers in our own fields, in our own demonstration plots, in our own orchards, and produce quality products.
The farm, which commenced in 2018, primarily specializes in tree seedlings. During our conversation, we explored the factors that motivated him to venture into tree cultivation.
I started growing trees in 2017, but I realized that the cost of seedlings and the quality of seedlings in the market do not meet the expectation. The cost is too high, the quality is poor. So we decided that we can raise our own seedlings. And when we got started, we realized that we could supply other people. And so we moved into this. But really, for me, the driving factor to start this kind of initiative is to support our communities in West Nile. You realize we are one of the poorest regions in the country, maybe after Eastern Uganda. Karamoja area and that. And one of the main reasons for the high levels of poverty is that we do not have, in the region, we do not have perennial crops. People rely mainly on annual crops. And secondly, over the years, the main cash crop here has been tobacco. And tobacco growing has led into degradation of our environment, because the type of tobacco grown is processed using fire, is flue cured, and because of that, a lot of trees have been destroyed. A lot of deforestation has taken place over the years. Now that has been compounded by the presence of refugees. Our communities host the largest refugee settlement in Africa, so the influx of refugees has also put a lot of pressure on the environment. A lot of trees are destroyed. So for us to make any change here, we need to plant a lot of trees. So with this in mind, I think an intervention like this to contribute towards planting more trees, improving food security through growing fruit trees, and of course growing trees that can be sold as timber and other products. And increasing income is an appropriate intervention for our region. And secondly, historically, some of our soils have been very poor. I've reviewed some reports, colonial reports of 1950s. There were reports on poor soils in Terego, in Maratsa. So it's been over a long period of time. So to address some of these persistent soil problems, we actually really need to plant a lot of trees to help our communities improve conditions of living. That is the food security and increasing incomes among households.
West Nile Foresters have now completed 5 years since its inception. During our discussion, we endeavored to assess the progress made thus far and determine whether it is still aligned with its original purpose.
We have completed developing the nursery. We have various kinds of trees that are grown here. We have fruit trees, we have a whole section there where we are standing. We have trees that grow for timber, firewood and other products. So we can say that in 3 years we have been able to complete developing the nursery. In the next phase, we are going to be focusing on training. We will provide training services here so that people can be able to competently plant and can grow trees. We want to train young people to grow trees. Then we want to go to the phase where we produce in the field, set up large farms and show people how this can be done. So we can say confidently that we have now completed developing the nursery, but now we need to move to the production age and the training phase.
What are the various technologies and machinery employed in farming to ensure profitability in agricultural operations?
We have, as I said, we have two broad sections. We have the section for fruit trees. So they are our main practices. We graft on a large scale, has avocado, and some of the fruits we produce, some of these indigenous fruit trees like jackfruit, other like guava and other, we don't graft them. Passion fruit, we don't really graft them. So there we do large scale grafting for has avocado. Here, where we're standing, the clonal section, we produce clonal eucalyptus on a very large scale. We produce clones from cuttings, propagate them vegetatively. And then also in the clone section we have rosemary. Again, it's propagated vegetatively. And then we have coffee. We also propagate that vegetatively, clonal coffee. So we do grafting, we do production of clones here. We have drip irrigation in the mother garden. We have set up a modern irrigation system that helps us to provide the water for the whole farm. And then we have constructed the two large greenhouses in this. And then we have a truck that facilitates us in moving the materials needed for this and also in distributing seedlings and taking them where they are needed. So these are our facilities here. And of course now we have trained, we have staff that are highly trained. We are managed by people who have diplomas in forestry. And then the local communities here, many of them youth. We have more women working here than men. And we train them to do this hands-on. So this is the facility we have here that enables us to be able to produce quality seedlings of various types.
Why is the presence of West Nile Foresters significant for the community?
All the people who work here, all those people who work here, apart from the managers, actually come from this community. We have about 40 people working here now. About 10 of them come on during peak periods, but about 30 of them come every day. So we only have 5 people who are out of this, who are from outside here. So the rest of the people are from this community. All these surrounding households around have at least one person working here. So most of the people who work here are actually members of this, and this supports their households a lot because we try to pay people promptly. promptly. Every month we pay people very promptly, so it helps them a lot. And also it has trained a lot of people. People are planting trees here. People who have worked here understand this, and then they be able to plant trees. And everyone who works here, we give them free seedlings. We encourage them to grow trees. If you're working here, if you don't have trees, what will you show what we are doing here? So towards the end of the season, those seedlings we haven't sold, we usually give to each of the workers here to go and plant in their homes and wherever they are. So everyone here at least has planted some trees. And because many of them come within this community, that way time will have some impact in the community.
The goal pursued by advocates of organic food and crop production is to eliminate the use of chemicals in farming. This approach aims to address the concerns of potential health issues and the detrimental impact on soils and the environment. Avoiding chemicals is a priority for both farmers and those striving to promote organic practices. In our interview with Dr. Oba, we explored whether they also refrain from using chemicals when planting trees on their farms.
In the clone section here, we use the chemical for encouraging root formation. As I said, we are producing these things from cuttings, not from seed. So to encourage root formation, we have to use a rooting chemical. What we use here is called Rootex, but that's really the name, but it encourages root formation. And then we have to control fungal diseases and some of the infections as a result of fungal diseases. When it is raining too much, it's cold, we suffer from damping off and all those. So we use Redomil Gold. That is something that we use. And then sometimes we also use Mister. And then one of the things we use, foliar fertilizer. We use a lot of foliar fertilizer here to encourage growing very fast. It's easy grow, which is from also chemicals. But in general, we try to minimize use of chemicals here because chemicals are used as a last resort. One of the key things we do is to make sure the place is very clean. So you eliminate host plants that would bring a lot of diseases. So we don't have very serious issues of outbreaks. So as you can see here, we keep the place very clean to minimize the instances of pests and the diseases. But where we see some indications of attack from pests, and then we use chemicals. But broadly, those are some of the chemicals we use. We also control ants in the mother garden. Eucalyptus has a lot of problems with the ants. So there are chemicals that we use for controlling ants. Sometimes we use things like rocket and others. Then Tafga for insects within the mother garden. But generally our use of chemicals here is minimum. We do that as and when it's really needed. But we emphasize more cultural practices than what. In the greenhouse for fruit trees, mostly we just use the foliar fertilizer and we don't see a lot of disease instances. So it's very rare that we actually do spray chemicals there. But the more chemicals are used here for propagating this through cuttings.
Dr. Oba employs vegetative propagation for his seed production, utilizing cuttings to generate seedlings. During our interview with him, we sought to understand the reasons behind his adoption of this innovative approach on his farm.
What we are producing here are hybrids. Like the eucalyptus we are talking here, the clonal eucalyptus. This one particular is called, they call them GCs, Grandis Camadolensis. That means it was a cross between Grandis eucalyptus and Camadolensis eucalyptus. So one of the best ways of maintaining that quality is to propagate it vegetatively. Because if you plant the seed, some variations would have been introduced through the pollination process. So to maintain that characteristic, some of the best ways is to just get it from the from the plant and you propagate it vegetatively. So to maintain that trait of the hybrid, it's better you actually use the one you propagate vegetatively. If the seeds produce at all, you might begin to see differences. They start differentiating. It's the same thing with the grafting. You want to get just a very similar plant from the parent one. Actually, the same plant from the parent one. The best way is also through grafting, or you do tissue culture. So that's why we insist in doing it vegetatively, so that we can maintain those traits that were originally derived from those two types of species of eucalyptus. And that's why for it grows faster than the other ordinary one. It grows faster, it is straight, and actually matures very fast and it has higher yield. So to maintain those traits, it's more appropriate to propagate them through cuttings.
What tree varieties are cultivated at the West Nile Foresters Farm?
We have pine. We produce pine. Again, we also have pine from the seeds that we get from Australia and sometimes Brazil last year. And usually it is Uganda Timber Growers Association that imports this, and then we buy from Utiga. The differences are very clear. The pine seedlings we get from Australia are from hybrids again. You know, hybrids grow faster. And so, yes, we produce that. That's preferred, but it's very, very expensive. And because of the cost, sometimes the seedlings are priced higher than what the communities might afford. So we also produce pine from local collections that we buy from NFA. And so we have pine, the hybrid seedlings, and those from local collections. We also produce the seedlings for some of the indigenous trees, like Melina borea, which does very well in the lower belt of this region. And then we have we also grow Gravilla, we grow Musizi, of course we grow Afizilia, we grow there. And then here we also, sometimes people need a lot of fencing, so we have K-apple here for that. And then we have Cassia there. From the fruit trees, that section, we have grafted mangoes, we have guava, we have jackfruit, we have passion fruit. Yeah, those are the main ones. Of course, the biggest there is Hass avocado, which we want to produce on a large scale.
Presently, the production of hybrids is gaining tremendous momentum, particularly in seedling farms, owing to its market demand and numerous benefits. However, this development raises concerns about the fate of our indigenous crops and plants. To address this, we approached Dr. Oba to inquire whether there are plans to revitalize our indigenous trees at the West Nile Foresters Farm.
In the fruit section there, actually most of the trees we are growing, most of the fruit trees are actually indigenous. For example, the passion fruit that we grow is this purple one. Some people call it masaka or whatever passion. That's what we grow. That's what people love a lot. So that's what we grow. Jackfruit is what we eat here mostly, with this yellow thing that we get the seeds from what people eat within here. The avocado is what people eat in the market. We grow that as rootstock, but then we get the scion. We get the scion from Mother Gardens in Kenya. So actually the fruits we produce are suited to this place, and many of them are the local ones. But the hybrid are for eucalyptus here, which also regenerates. Once you cut it, it copies and what? It grows again and again. It doesn't really have a difference with what? Our local one, except that it has a higher output, and it has a higher output and matures faster. So those are so there's no worry about our local trees and all that, because most of the trees we also produce here are really have now become indigenous trees.
The marketing of harvest has proven to be one of the most difficult aspects of farming, leading to a significant number of local farmers abandoning the industry. During the interview with Dr. Obar, we delved into his strategies for effectively addressing this issue.
One of our challenges is actually marketing, and it is because people still don't take tree planting as a main activity to earn a living. Many people don't really understand that you can actually grow trees to earn a decent living. Because of that, few people actually grow trees for commercial purposes, at least in this region. We're trying to address that through education and talking to people and having radio programs and all that. The other problem with marketing is the corruption in supply system, in tenders and in government, NGOs and organizations that actually buy trees for communities or for farmer groups and all that. There's a lot of corruption in the bid processes for these things. And sometimes it gets very difficult if you don't have the networks to have that. Sometimes quality doesn't matter. Yet for us here, we emphasize quality. Sometimes quality doesn't matter. And people give tenders, people give supplies to in their own network. And sometimes it's inside that job if you go to ministry, environment, and so many times people who supply those seedlings are people who are actually working within the organization. So it gets very difficult for establishment like ours to actually get supplies, yet we produce quality seedlings. So for us, our emphasis actually is now more on individual tree growers, small scale, medium scale, and large scale tree growers. People come here on bicycles, they buy seedlings worth 5,000. Some come in big vehicles, they buy seedlings worth 20 million. So we're encouraging individuals to just grow trees, and we think that is more sustainable than building a business on supplies, which has a lot of problems, which is really affected by corrupt tendencies and practices everywhere, whether it's an international organization or across the board. Government departments, NGOs, and all that. So that's a challenge in marketing. And for our business, it's very critical because it's very expensive to produce seedlings. So what you produce needs actually to be either sold or you need to plant it yourself. So now, if you don't do these two, then a lot of loss is incurred. The best way would have been you produce on order. But the market doesn't work like that. Even organizations that look for seedlings, what they do, they just come here and say, we want 20,000, do you have clones? But when you are trying to reason, say, what are your expectations for the next year, for next season, so that we can produce this in advance, say, you see our procurement process, we don't know, we are still putting up these things together. And so nobody really tells you that this is what they will buy. So you try to guess where the demand might be. If you guess it wrongly, you lose money by producing in excess and people don't buy, or you lose money by not having seedlings when people want seedlings. So that's another challenge that we have. But this business is best if organizations, individuals who are very organized, say, next season, I think I might need this from you. So produce this so we can have our targets based on appropriate demand. So that's the challenge in marketing.
Thoroughly maintaining farm records is essential when making significant business or planning choices for your operation. Failing to keep track of farming activities not only reflects poorly on your business practices, but may also be deemed illegal. We made an effort to determine if the West Nile foresters have proper record keeping, and here is what Dr. Ba shared with us.
We keep records of everything. All the activities here, we keep records. Actually, every activity here has a record. Where we are, the clone section, we keep records of how many insertions are in each tunnel and how many of those have survived. We calculate the survival rate. And then we trace that up to when they come here where we are standing. How many of those things we planted there have reached up to this stage. And from here, how many are ready for sale? And how many of these have been bought? And what? So we have a record of everything, all the chemicals you use, how much has been used for each of these things, and when they were done. The regimes for spraying, of course the staff records are kept. We have records for all the tools we use here. We have a record of all the expenditures we have. For every sale here, they have to issue a receipt and a delivery note. And so for all the incomes, they have to be banked, unless for special cases, and then got from the bank to pay. So we keep records of everything. And we have a visitor's book there, all the everything is recorded. A record here is complete for everything we have.
Family always takes precedence in all our endeavors, and their significant involvement often plays a major role in shaping the outcomes of our business. We sought to explore this aspect in Dr. Oba's farm.
The family has been the one who is mostly involved. But again, this is because we've just been building this place. We've been building the place, and then we're going to build in the systems for putting everything in a place and like that. So for me, one of my main issues is to involve the family fully in this. The children should be able to come here and work during the holidays, instead of being somewhere during the holidays, to come here and learn how to work and how to work here. A lot of hands-on experience, they understand these processes, and eventually they can be able to get interested in this. So I would like to involve the children as much as possible in this. This is where they spend their holidays, on the farm, not watching TVs. So when they grow up and they understand these processes, it's likely that they may be able to get interested in this and what. So because we are just starting and things are just taking off, this has been a phase for building the place. But now where we have raised, I think now the children are going to start working here. My wife is going to be involved in this, in managing some of the books, because she's an accountant, so a certified public accountant, so she can help us in managing this and understand financial aspects and all that. So we are moving into that direction of making sure that this has sustainability beyond me as an individual. But the main thing I've done here is to make sure that it's professionally run, because I have a manager for the section here, clones, a manager for the food section, and so even if I'm not here, these are professionals, and so this will be a system in a place where these things can run. Even if I'm not here, these processes actually go on, even though I would really love to be here every single day.
Everyone's goal in starting a business is to achieve success, regardless of the challenges they may face. Reaching a point where one can openly share their achievements without fear is a significant milestone. Dr. Ba exemplifies this as he discusses the accomplishments he has attained since establishing the West Nile Foresters Farm.
This farm, the way it is established, in itself is an achievement, because we started on 2 acres here where we're standing, 2 acres. But as the business progresses, we've been able to buy the rest of the one. So some of the money we get here, we top up to expand the land. So now we're talking about 8 acres, but we started on 2 acres. So in that in itself is a very big achievement. We did not have this land like this, and we just bought it like this. These are pieces of land owned by different people. It's not one big one. So we started on 2. We bought the other extension, then we bought that with that extension. Now it looks a big farm, one like it was never like this. So this in itself is what we have. But because we have been continuously trying to expand and build this, we are still recovering. We're still recovering costs. We've not started getting money out of it. We're still recovering costs, paying some of the monies I borrowed and the things. So we're in that phase of trying to break even. So in itself, that is an achievement. And the other thing also is it has transformed a lot of this. And I'm happy that many people have been able to plant and people come to us and thank us for giving them very good seedlings. We're getting very good feedback from that. We are encouraging people to plant trees. They are taking this positively. So when we go and see the forest established from our seedlings, we feel very happy. And for me, that's really what my, because we are increasing the tree cover in West Nile. And so some of the achievements we have is that we have also been able to partner with some organizations to do source protection for the river that supplies the rural city with water. So some of the seedlings to do that, to protect the water source that supplies the city, some of the seedlings have come from us. So for us, we see that as a what? As a positive contribution. We have supplied a lot of seedlings through Caritas to refugee communities in Yumbe.
This episode of the Harvest Money Show centered on the business of tree planting with a primary focus on the nursery bed. We have exciting content in store for you in future episodes. Until next time, have a fantastic week and goodbye.